The Oracle Network.
Hey, listeners.
Yeah,
we're talking to you. We're Depth of Darkness, the podcast that dives deep into all things dark and wrong in this world. I'm Mandy.
I'm retired major, huge ass. In your face.
If you like true crime, horror movie reviews, real-life paranormal experiences, creepypastas, and diving deep into the unknown, then join us on this journey into the darkness. You can find us on all podcast platforms simply by searching Depth of Darkness. So go ahead, give us a listen. You know you want to.
Hey, 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 Rainbow Warriors. This is my disclaimer. Beyond the Rainbow is a true crime podcast. It's not suitable for young children, and maybe not even for some adults. I tend to swear like a sailor, and I'm kind of proud of that. Listener discretion is advised.
Hey there, Rainbow Warriors, and welcome to Beyond the Rainbow, True Crimes of the LGBT. I'm your host, CJ. Find me on the socials, Facebook at Beyond the Rainbow Podcast, Instagram at Beyond the Rainbow Pod, or Rainbow Crimes 12, Twitter, Tumblr, and TikTok at Rainbow Crimes. Speaking of TikTok, I have a song I'd like to play for you that was written and performed by a TikToker. He calls himself Guy with the Hair. I asked him if I could play his song on my podcast, and he said, of course. So take a listen.
I fucking stand in support of LGBTQ. And if you don't accept people for who they are, then fucking shame on you. And if you give me that bullshit that the Bible says it's bad, then your ignorance is based in fiction, which is fucking sad. Let's put your homophobia aside for a quick second. How the fuck does it affect your life if someone's bi, gay, or lesbian? It doesn't. People are goddamn people, and love is fucking love. How are we so goddamn close-minded in fucking 2021? So whether you're gay, bi, trans, pan, asexual, or you're not sure, don't let the hateful words of other people keep you from discovering how beautiful you are down to your core. So to the homophobic nation, you should know this generation's getting more fucking diverse. So quit looking for reasons to hate other people and worry about your own ignorance first.
I was so impressed with Guy with the Hair's musical beats. And I was excited when he told me I could play it for you guys. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. If you get a chance and you're on TikTok, be sure to follow Guy with the Hair. He's got a lot of cool lyrics he sings. If you'd like to help support Beyond the Rainbow, I have two links that can help you do that. One is for my Rainbow Crime swag store at TeePublic, and the other's for my Buy Me a Coffee account. Any monies received will go towards upgrading this podcast. And if it doesn't, I'll buy you a coffee. Also on my website is a list of missing but not forgotten LGBTQ people. My website is beyondtherainbowpodcast.com, and I'll link it in the show notes. This episode's missing but not forgotten LGBTQ person is J.L. Hildebrand. J.L. was born William Wayne Hildebrand. The Charlie Project page on JL doesn't state JL is a trans woman, but looking at the page, I'm going to make the hard assumption that JL is either trans or gender nonconforming. Since I'm not 100% positive of JL's proper pronouns, I'll address JL as they or them. JL was last seen at the Joshua Chamberlain Bridge over the Penobscot River. This was just before midnight on November 4, 2010. The Joshua Chamberlain Bridge is in Bangor, Maine. Passing motorists called the police to report a woman standing at the edge of an overpass near the Bangor side of the river. When police arrived, they witnessed JL jump into the freezing water below. JL is an excellent swimmer, but the water was so cold, hypothermia could have set in within minutes. Police found JL's purse on the bridge with their cell phone and ID belonging to them. JL was declared legally dead 4 years later in 2014, although no body has been recovered and the case remains open. JL was only 22 at the time of their disappearance, but they had a history of suicide attempts. JL is Native American from the Passamaquoddy Indian tribe. JL has black hair, hazel eyes, stands at 5'10", and weighs 150 pounds. Should anyone listening have any answers to JL's mysterious disappearance, please call the Bangor Police Department at area code 207-947-7382. Well, it happened the other night, Warriors. God spoke to me. He told me I had to order rainbow love stickers and have my following put these stickers over all Trump or mega stickers that they might see on cars or trucks. I was told we are to call it the Rainbow Warrior Movement. I'm just fucking with you. Only because I do talk a lot about the kooks who say God speaks to them. But Warriors, you really can't blame me for always bringing religion up. Since a lot of the crimes against LGBTQ are intermingled with others' religious views. It's kind of fitting that I'm writing this episode on May 17th, International Day Against Homophobia, Transphobia, and Biphobia. Now, I know the episode won't get to you until several days later. I just thought it was kind of a coincidence that May 17th is the day I began writing this episode. This episode, I'm going to feel my way around the topics of Islam, Muslims, the Sharia law, honor killings, and Islamic terrorist groups who kill LGBTQ members. If you are listening and are of the Islamic faith, please bear with me as I try to break it all down so I can follow what I'm saying easier. I'm sure if I've gotten any of it wrong, I'll get an email telling me so. But in the meantime, my goal is to simplify a topic that gets very confusing for me. To start, let's define Islam. Islam is a religion or a belief. Muslims are people who practice the religion of Islam. Allah is the God. Muhammad is the prophet who wrote the Quran, which is the Islamic book used in their religious teachings. To compare, Christianity is a religion or belief. Christians are people who practice the religion of Christianity. God is, well, God. Jesus is God's son. And there's a shitload of prophets who wrote the Bible, which is Christianity's book of religious teachings, and it comes in a variety of editions. Both the Quran and the Bible are books written by people claiming their God spoke to them and wanted his words in a book for people to live by. The authors, mostly men, are commoners, no different than you or I, with the exception that they claim their God spoke to them. Bullshit. I want proof. Let me listen to the taped recording of God speaking to these so-called prophets. As I've stated before, I'm not an atheist. I have my beliefs. Prophets are not in my belief system. I believe people who think God has spoken to them so they can spread their God's word are mentally ill or just plain manipulative. And to interpret any fictional book to fit your hateful agenda against anyone, well, that's just plain wrong. Yet it happens daily all around the world. Okay, so moving past definitions with some more comparisons. Islamic terrorist groups such as Islamic State and ISIS are comparable to the Christian Identity Movement and the Aryan Brotherhood for their treatment of the LGBTQ. The Islamic terrorist groups who prey on gays have interpreted a line from the Quran that reads, "Men having sex with other men should be punished." The Quran never says how to punish, but the terrorist groups make their own translation of that by blindfolding suspected gay men and pushing them off of tall buildings. Should the gay man survive the fall, he is pelted with stones from the watching crowd below until he dies. Honor killings are probably one of the saddest things to happen to LGBTQ because the victim is murdered by their own families, their own flesh and blood. The following case was suggested by Rainbow Warrior Jeremy a few days ago on Facebook. The case happened earlier this month in May 2021. Alireza Manfarad was a very handsome gay 20-year-old Iranian man. He was being summoned by the Iranian military to register and serve his country. Alireza, lovingly called Ali, didn't want to be in the military. He wanted to leave Iran for a country more tolerant of the homosexual lifestyle. Ali wanted to be a model or a makeup artist. Ali had the looks for modeling for sure. He always wore designer clothing and he looked very fashionable. He was his mother's only child. He had half-siblings from his dad who was married prior to Ollie's mom. Ali also had a boyfriend. The boyfriend had fled to Turkey 3 years prior in 2018. Ali met his boyfriend through an online Iranian dating site for LGBTQ people. His boyfriend, also Iranian. After the couple met online, they would chat on the phone often. And soon they started to send video chats to one another. Ali told his boyfriend about the military contacting him to register and serve. He also told his boyfriend he was going to apply for an exemption card. The exemption card is for trans and gays to not have to serve the military because of medical reasons. The medical reason is mental illness. Because if you're LGBTQ in Iran, well, you're obviously mentally sick. The exemption card was essentially a double-edged sword. It permitted you an excuse from serving in the military, but it also put a huge rainbow target on your back. On May 2nd, Ali spoke to his boyfriend on the phone. He told him he received his exemption card in the mail, but it looked as though the envelope had been opened and resealed. Ali told his boyfriend of his plan. In the next few days, he was going to be taking the steps to join the boyfriend in Turkey. He would first go to the phone store and get his phone switched out. Then he would go to the city and get his COVID shots for travel. And he would buy his train ticket to Turkey. He should be in Turkey by May 7th. May 4th came, and Ali's boyfriend had not heard from him since they spoke on the 2nd. The boyfriend started to worry about Ali. He tried to reach him on the phone, but there was no answer, and Ali was not returning his messages. The boyfriend called Ali's mom, who he called Mama Ali. Mama Ali thought the boyfriend and her son were just platonic friends. From the boyfriend's conversation with Mama Ali and Ali's aunt, the boyfriend was able to surmise what happened to Ali. Mama Ali told the boyfriend, "He's dead. He's in the morgue." When she could no longer speak, the aunt got on the phone and said they had killed Ali. She told the boyfriend she had went to the store Ali was at, and the storekeeper gave her more details. The storekeeper said while Ali was at the store, a man came in and told Ali his father needed to see him. So Ali followed the man outside, and he was pushed into a car with three men. The car drove off. Ali's body was found in a remote nearby village, his head nearly decapitated from his body. The aunt continued that Ali's murder was committed by members of Ali's extended family. There's been no arrests, no trials, no convictions, no punishment for Ali's murder. Ali's half-brother is the one who opened Ali's exemption card from the military, and then he snitched to family members about Ali's homosexuality. The boyfriend who waited so patiently for his love, his handsome, kind young man to arrive, will never get to see the future he dreamed of with Ollie. Ollie's murder was an honor killing. Ollie, being gay, brought dishonor to his family, and they murdered him. This report just came out a few days ago. To honor Ollie, LGBT in Iran are wearing pride flags. They're wearing them to protest honor killings and the treatment of the LGBT community in Iran. And while I admire this sentiment, I worry for our LGBTQ brothers and sisters that are so boldly doing this. Please be safe out there. In an attempted honor killing attack in 2019, a 17-year-old Iraqi boy named Saran nearly died. Saran was living with his family in Switzerland. Saran's dad was standing over his bed with a knife one night. Saran woke to a feeling of a presence standing over him. When Saran opened his eyes, he saw his father, who started screaming at him.
"Are you gay? Are you gay?"
Saran was not given a chance to answer when his father sliced across his throat and chest. Saran fought back the best he could, and it gave him ample time to run outside and climb across to the neighbor's balcony. From there, the police were called. The neighbors tried to stop Saran's bleeding until emergency services arrived. Thankfully, he survived. But he looks in the mirror every day at the scars left on his neck and chest by his father. He lives on his own now, and he's very grateful to feel free from the restraints of his imposing father. In 2008, a 26-year-old Turkish hairy bear named Ahmet Yildiz might be the very first gay man reported as an honor killing in Turkey. Ahmet was born into a wealthy and religious Turkish family in an impoverished little city. When he started college, he moved to Istanbul, where he would have more freedom away from his family to live as a gay man. Ahmet loved the new life he was creating in Istanbul. He had new friends and a boyfriend, who he moved in with eventually. Ahmet was a physics student at the university. He received straight A's always, and he wanted to teach someday. He didn't want to hide who he was, and he started to come out to everyone in his life. He even called his family and told them. His father was not pleased. He urged Ahmet to come home and see a doctor for a cure and to get married. But Ahmet apologized to his father for being gay, and he told his father no, he couldn't do that. Shortly after, Ahmet began receiving death threats from his family. Ahmet quickly filed a criminal complaint against them, and he asked for protection. After a few months, his complaint was completely dismissed. On July 15, 2008, Ahmet had been in his apartment with his boyfriend studying. He decided he needed a break, and he asked his boyfriend if he wanted to go get ice cream with him. The boyfriend was involved in his own work, and he said he couldn't. So Ahmet gave him a kiss and promised he'd be back with ice cream for him. Ahmet went downstairs and outside to where his car was parked. He got into his car, and at that moment, a black Mercedes speeding down the road squealed to a stop next to Ahmet's car. A man got out of the Mercedes. He bent and he peered into Ahmet's car, and he fired 5 shots from a gun he was holding. The gunman got back into his car and he sped off. Ahmet was struck by all 5 bullets, but he tried to drive away. He crashed into a nearby pharmacy, and there he took his last breath. In the apartment, Ahmet's boyfriend heard the commotion of the speeding car squealing to a stop. He looked out of the apartment window in horror as he watched Ahmet being murdered. Ahmet's father was the trigger man, and he went on the run. As of 2015, Ahmet's father was still in hiding, but I don't think authorities are truly looking very hard for him because he is said to still be in contact with his family. If law enforcement wanted him badly enough, they could get him. In October of 2016, a Muslim father went on television to issue a permen, which is an invitation for anyone to kill his Muslim transgender daughter. The daughter, Reina Aliv, born Adam Aliv, had escaped a year prior from her family to Moscow, Russia. She was living her best life in Moscow. She worked, she had gender reassignment surgery, she had a boyfriend who accepted who she was, and she was getting married to him that very month. Life was good, until her father discovered her happy life in Moscow and went on television to say,
"Let him be killed. I don't want to see him. Bring him here and kill him in front of my eyes."
Reina's mother said,
"I gave birth to a son, but what for? Such a disgrace for the family."
An unknown someone or someones took Reina's father up on his request. It happened only days after Reina married the man of her dreams, Victor, in Moscow. Reina's body had been cut up so badly, it was unrecognizable to anyone who knew her. No justice has been served for Reina's murder. Several years ago, a lesbian Norwegian author named Lien Wold was writing a book called Honor Killing, A Father and Daughter Tell Their Story. The book is a fascinating account of a Jordanian woman who now lives off the grid because she's scared of getting murdered by her family. Lien spent 5 years in the country of Jordan, knowing, as a lesbian, her life would always be in danger in a Middle Eastern country. Lien lied that she had a husband and a child when someone asked her, just to avoid persecution. I've seen a picture of Lien, and she's definitely trade. She could pass for heterosexual. To get her interview with Amina, who was now 40 years old in 2016, Lien had to give up her cell phone and be blindfolded by the driver, a man she never met before. And I'm sure that had to be terrifying. The drive into the desert to meet Amina took many hours. But when she finally arrived, she was let out of the car, and she walked to where a hijab-covered Amina sat in her tent. The spot was desolate and surrounded by mountains. Amina greeted Lien, and she removed her hijab that kept her hair, part of her face, and neck hidden. When it was removed, Lien was able to see deep scars over Amina's nose, cheek, and eye. These scars were remnants Amina carried through her life from an attack her parents made on her when she was just 16. As a teenager, Amina and her older sister Aisha had been close. But at the age of 18, Aisha began acting differently. She was becoming secretive, and she was spending an awful lot of time with her married friend, a woman named Maram. Aisha was even able to invite Maram on a family holiday to the Red Sea. One night on the trip, Amina heard Aisha and Maram profess their love for each other. Amina was in disbelief and scared for her sister. She knew if anyone aside from her family found out Aisha was a lesbian, she would be in great danger. Homosexuality is forbidden under Sharia law. Not knowing what to do or how to help her sister, Amina told her mother. After all, her parents were their protectors, right? That's how it's supposed to work. Honor and dignity is never supposed to supersede a parent's love for their child. Not ever. But the girl's very conservative, religious mother's dark brown eyes turned black with disgust and rage. She screamed hatred at Aisha. She spat on her and she forbade her to ever see Maram again. Both sisters became terrified of their parents. Both sisters who knew their father, who they called Baba, had killed his own mother for honor when he was 11. Baba's mother had run out on the family because she was being abused by her husband, Baba's father. Other kids in the community taunted Baba and his brother. the kids called their mother a whore and said that their father was a sorry excuse for a man not controlling his woman. When Baba's mother returned, Baba was encouraged by his father and brother to kill her and restore the family name. An 11-year-old boy. Baba took a steel wire and he strangled his mother. Baba told his daughters he lived with extreme guilt afterwards, but he knew he had to do it to restore honor to his family name. After that, the men of the family were no longer shunned by their community. But Baba left his father and brother when he was old enough to. He didn't want his future family to live with that type of violence. Baba's daughters still feared death to Aisha was most likely inevitable. Their father had murdered his own mother because of the shame she had caused him. Amina started to have panic attacks. Aisha took Amina to the hospital. The doctor treating Amina learned of the family's situation, and he contacted the police. This made the girl's home situation even worse. Aisha was put in prison for her own protection, and her absence led to rumors in the community that Aisha must be involved in immoral acts. The family was ostracized by neighbors and friends, and this started to take Baba back to his childhood. In order to get Aisha back from prison, Baba had to sign a document stating he forgave her and he would protect her. Within days of Aisha returning home, the girl's parents started to put in motion a plan that they'd been contriving since they discovered Aisha was a lesbian. One evening, the parents dragged the girls from their beds into the living room. They forced them into chairs and they bound them to those chairs. Baba held a knife in one hand and a gun in the other. Amina was thought to be conspiring with Aisha, so in her parents' eyes, she too was guilty of shaming the family. The sisters held hands as they shook in fear in their chairs. Amina was struck in the head with something, causing her to black out. When she came to, Baba was coming at her with the knife. He plunged it into her chest. Amina could see Baba had already killed Aisha. Baba put the gun to Amina's face and he fired. Somehow, Amina was able to live through this vicious attack by her parents. When she recovered from her injuries, she was imprisoned for 13 years for her own protection. Baba was arrested, but he didn't spend near the time Amina did in prison. When Amina was secretly released from prison, she immediately went into hiding in her remote location. She still fears the parents who once tried to kill her will find her and finish the job. Any LGBTQ living in Islamic State or ISIS-controlled territories is in danger of losing their lives at the hand of any Islamic terrorist group. Don't think these groups don't have their share of fucking hypocrites either. They most certainly do. I remember reading a while back, a general in one of the terrorist hate groups, I think it was Islamic State, he had been fooling around with a boy about 14 years old. When the general was caught, his hand was slapped, and he was demoted from his rank. But the poor underage boy was murdered. In 2014, a 26-year-old man named Faraj Shawi was living in his hometown of Derna, Libya. Faraj was an impeccably dressed man with a keen sense of fashion. His style was tightly embraced by his small circle of friends. But Faraj's neighbors constantly raised their eyebrows in suspicion. They thought Faraj was too clean, too well-dressed, too effeminate. Only 50 miles west of Derna is the much larger city of Beida. Faraj was well acquainted with this city because that's where he graduated from the university there. In Beida, Faraj felt free to be more open with his homosexuality. Also in Beida, Faraj met a 40-year-old man who ran a clothing store. His name was Syed. The two soon became very close. Faraj was so happy in his new relationship, he told a close friend about Syed. The relationship between the couple flourished, but the men were very careful. They did not want to be outed in public. Unfortunately, the couple didn't go without notice. In November of 2014, the couple were in Derna, which is where Faraj is from. They were walking on the boardwalk, and they were just simply walking, talking, and laughing. But they were stopped by Islamic officers. The couple was questioned, searched, and released with the warning not to loiter in the area. A month later, Faraj and Syed vanished. The couple's friends learned through the grapevine that the couple had been detained again by Islamic officers, this time for homosexual conduct in a parked car. They were held in an unknown location for 5 months by an Islamic State terrorist group. On April 30, 2015, the two men and a third man also accused of homosexuality were brought to the courtyard of the Sahaba Mosque, where masked men awaited them, blindfolded, kneeling with their hands tied. They were each shot in the back of the head. The masked men yelled,
"Allahu Akbar,"
which translated means, "God is most great." Well, I'm sorry to break it to you guys. God is not most great if he is a hateful God. But that's just it. The higher being people pray to is not the hateful one. It's the people who twist these fictional books they deem holy into what they want it to mean that are hateful. God, whichever one they believe in, is only their scapegoat. There's many stories such as these I shared with you, far too many. Will the hate ever end? Will religious groups ever stay out of people's fucking bedrooms? Will they ever quit preaching from these fictional books and start preaching from their hearts? If they have hate to spew, let them have the balls to claim it's from them, not a God they pretend to worship. Because no holy God would be so evil and vile to want to kill another person for who they choose to love or who they are. Let me close with playing Guy with the Hair song one more time.
I fucking stand in support of LGBTQ. And if you don't accept people for who they are, then fucking shame on you. And if you give me that bullshit that the Bible says it's bad, then your ignorance is based in fiction, which is fucking sad. Let's put your homophobia aside for a quick second. How the fuck does it affect your life if someone's bi, gay, or lesbian? It doesn't. People are goddamn people, and love is fucking love. How are we so goddamn close-minded in fucking 2021? So whether you're gay, bi, trans, pan, asexual, or you're not sure, don't let the hateful words of other people keep you from discovering how beautiful you are down to your core. So to the homophobic nation, you should know this generation's getting more fucking diverse. So quit looking for reasons to hate other people and worry about your own ignorance first.
Love you, Rainbow Warriors. Remember, it's not a crime to be gay, trans, bi, or to love who you love. Unless you're a murderer.